Thank you, Mr. Srinivasan. Thank you, Sanjoy, for making this happen today. Delighted to be amongst a lot of good friends, but even more delighted to be with the true young brigade here. I didn't realize I'm still young. At least it makes me feel good that somebody thinks I'm still young. But I think it's a delight to see all the youngsters who I'm told are continuously engaged with the Hindu business line and are really interested and involved in knowing what's happening in the business world, in the economy. And more so, since I'm told that all of you even pay a subscription to be a part of the digital world that Hindu business line has promoted, which is even more interesting because I thought nowadays it's only everything free that matters. Paying for something is probably becoming outdated and old-fashioned nowadays. So it's great to hear and see that we have youngsters amongst us today. We've just been through the budget for 18-19. Before that, the president's address. And in some sense, both of these are extremely important documents because the president's address at the beginning of the year is somewhat a report card of the incumbent government. He lays out what has been achieved, what has been done by the government over the previous 12 months and over its tenure in a broader sense. And the budget sets out the vision for tomorrow. And therefore, both these documents have to be seen and read and understood together. We had the privilege of Prime Minister Modi responding to the debate on the President's address in both houses of Parliament. Of course, the Lok Sabha debate was in the midst of a lot of disturbances. The Rajya Sabha debate was with a lot of humor. But I think in some sense, in both these responses, the Prime Minister was able to lay out the style of working of this government. It has been a government that has not looked at quick band-aid solutions for the immense problems that the country has faced, many of which we inherited after nearly 7 decades of independence. He spoke about the government's sensitivity to the poor, to the marginalized sections of society, to sections which have, if I may use an analogy from my own department, who have not yet boarded the train, despite so many years of independent free India. He spoke about the speed with which projects were being executed, the fact that this government is not only looking at outlays, but is more focused on the outcome for every rupee that is spent, as they would say, getting the bang out of every buck that is spent by the government, because ultimately we are spending your money. Money that belongs to the people of India, money that many of you have paid in your taxes, money that is collected in different forms from the people for different services provided. He spoke about the fact that it has been a corruption-free government, a breath of fresh air after many years of sensational corruption in almost every area of government. It's been a period of good governance, and governance goes beyond integrity. Governance also means ease of business. It also means better competitiveness when it comes to running your business. It involves the government acting as a facilitator, particularly to the youth of India, when they're trying to become job creators rather than job seekers, entrepreneurs, honest businessmen. And I'm using the word honest with a lot of responsibility, yet realizing that this may not be the best venue to use that word. because it may lead to acrimony or misunderstanding with a lot of my friends. And it's no judgment on all business. I'm proud to say that our country has the likes of, and without taking names, some very, very eminent business houses and business persons, large and small, who have done the nation proud with their good work, with their integrity levels that they have brought to fore. And then we've had our fair share of people who are looking at shortcuts, the get-rich-quick variety, who are willing to break the rules and bend the rules, including bending the way bank loans have been given for so many years. And Finance Minister Mr. Jetley brought to fore how the last three and a half years is a period that makes every Indian proud. Certainly, no other large country in the world of the size of India has ever attempted a transformational tax reform like GST, ever. We are the first large country to have taken such a bold decision, knowing full well that no government in the world which introduced GST has ever won the next election after that. Knowing full well how unpopular demonetization could have been, Prime Minister Modi, Finance Minister Mr. Jetley had the ability, and which is why we say policy paralysis is now history. We are looking at prosperity through hard decisions, through bold decisions. And demonetization many times is being belittled as only calculating the amount of currency that came back into the Reserve Bank and the fact that most of it did come back, without realizing the holistic vision behind such a transformational step. And I'm delighted that we have Mr. Shaktikant Das here. He's been a part of the demonetization exercise and the remonetization exercise all through those trying months. And I tell you, it was a delight to see officers like him really hands-on to address issues that came up on a daily basis, on an hourly basis, in a very cool, calm, composed way, addressing the challenges of such a major decision, knowing full well that what we are doing is in the best interest of the country in the long run. And while I can go on and on about the benefits of demonetization, right from the impact it had on terrorist activities, on Naxalite and Maoist activities in the jungles of Jharkhand and Chhattisgarh, to the fact that we were able to bring a lot of businesses into the formal economy from the informal economy where they never paid their taxes, the fact that today we have many, many, many more new income taxpayers, GST payers, which otherwise were, in fact, not even willing to consider coming into the formal economy. The fact that millions and millions of our families are now covered by Provident Fund, health benefits under the Employee State Insurance Scheme, actually getting minimum wages without having to pay a cut to the local mafia or the local goon, which had almost become a way of life, for example, in the tea gardens of West Bengal. And I can go on and on to describe and explain the benefits. Look at the fact that 1,000 rupees and 500 rupee notes were being stacked up and stored, not brought into circulation for years altogether, as was reported by the Reserve Bank to us, that nearly 6 lakh crore rupees in high value currency is not in circulation at all, because those serial numbers have never come back into the banking system for many years, possibly stored and stacked away somewhere or the other. Nobody knows. Nearly 6 lakh crore rupees, and ultimately that's national wealth which is becoming unproductive. The fact that many of us are aware that 500 and 1,000 rupee notes in large measure were counterfeit, But duplicate notes, and I think it had almost become common for all of us to go to a bank or to go to a restaurant and get one or two notes back saying that, no, this one is a fake note. Now, all said and done, all of that is history. And it could not have been done unless one was willing to really bite the bitter pill. Of course, we recently heard a comment. I, for one, haven't been able to figure it out, but if Hindu business sign can help me, educate me, what was the philosophy behind that comment? I'll be blessed. But I was told, or we were, all of us were told, that the government and the Prime Minister are doing rear view mirror driving. Now, thank God we take care of the country, we keep a watch on what's happening in the country, we keep a watch on what's happening behind us. Because the kind of economy that we inherited, which was going downhill, if in that economy, when the car is going downhill, if we had pressed the accelerator without looking what's, where we are and what's happening, God forbid what would have happened to this country. I remember when I first learned to drive a car. Since many of you may have been to Mumbai, you may be aware that at Pedder Road, just before Jaslok Hospital, the road goes uphill. And soon after I turned 18 and I was really just getting into the mold of driving the car, it was a very, very rainy day. And I was on the wheel, my father was with me, and Mr. Vajpayee was sitting behind me. And on that heavy rain pouring down, we were trying to go uphill. And I still remember the most important thing was to keep your foot balanced between the accelerator and the brake. If any of you recalls when you first learned to drive, and if you're trying to go uphill, and it's pouring like cats and dogs like it does in Mumbai, You're all the time conscious and looking at the rearview mirror to see that you don't slide down and bang into some car behind you. And therefore, your leg is not on the accelerator or on the brake, because the second leg used to be on the clutch in those good old days of driving with clutches in the car and not automatic driving. So you really had to have your foot balancing the brake and the accelerator to make sure the car is moving upward and doesn't slide back. So you press the brake to stop it from sliding back, accelerate to go up, and that's what is good maneuvering of a vehicle by a decent driver. And I'm very, very happy and proud to say we have our eyes on the rear view mirror. We are watching what is happening. We ensure that every step we take has the desired outcome that we are looking for. And wherever we find that something is not up to the mark or could have been done better, we are willing to reassess, reorient our work. We are not ostrich in our mentality. It's not my way or the highway. If something better comes to our attention, we are happy and delighted to correct it. We are looking at mid-course correction if something is not necessarily right. We have never given excuses that we had a coalition compulsion, therefore, we could let away a large scam go by and we just closed our eyes in government, sitting in government. Of course, a lot is being made out that no conviction was made of the accused in the 2G scam. I think it's very surprising, and in that sense, I'd like to ask my friends from the media also whether they've really looked at the judgment, what the judgment says. The entire inquiry was done while the Congress was in power. They appointed all the officials who ran the inquiry. All the hearings were completed before we came into government. After we came into government, I think most of the hearings were only about whether the passport should be given or not be given, and whether any of the accused should be allowed to travel abroad or not be allowed to travel abroad. The entire process was run through the UPA's tenure, and the judge has passed very stinking observations. The Honourable Judge has said that the case has not been presented properly. The evidence has not been alluded to in full spirit and with factual supporting documents. And in some sense, it really makes one wonder whether justice is truly being allowed to happen and whether there was some kind of a cover-up operation to try and protect. And the greatest thing is the accused. And after all, the Supreme Court has already cancelled all those licenses with strictures being passed on the allotment process. And it's not as if that process has been validated by the CBI Special Court judge. He has passed serious comments about the entire investigation and the process, but expressed helplessness on his ability to get adequate evidence. And therefore, I'm delighted that we are keeping a watch on our backside to make sure that nothing wrong happens in our charge, that nobody is able to misuse government positions and government offices while we are in government. And therefore, I believe a cautious structural improvement which prepares the nation for a long period of prosperity rather than shortcuts is the way that this government believes is good for India. That is how we have been taking the country forward step by step. After all, becoming the world's fastest growing large economy is certainly not a mean achievement. It's truly very, very exciting to be a part of a journey which is being recognized the world over. Every indice says that the economy is in good hands, is in good shape. We were the toast of Davos this year. I'm given to understand informally that the American president, who also came first time after many years, 17 years or so, was extremely keen that the opening plenary be given to America, and that's the way America always looks at itself as the supreme power, so everything has to be as per their diktat. But Professor Klaus Schwab and the Davos team gave Prime Minister Modi the opportunity to be the speaker at the opening plenary, the first time an Indian has ever been given that honor, and the American president had to give a special address in conclusion. We've seen the economy go from strength to strength over the last 3.5 years, save and except for a couple of quarters blip, largely related to the rollout of the GST, which was on expected lines. Upfront, we had told the nation that there is going to be a destocking in the quarter before GST, and a certain period when people are getting used to this massive change that GST entailed. But despite that, from a GDP growth of 5.3 or 6.3% in the last 2 years of the UPA government, I think the GDP that the BJP-led NDA government has given to this nation is certainly a matter of great satisfaction for us. I believe we'll close this year upwards of 6.7%. Next year should, to my mind, cross 7.5%. All the signs are there for us to see. A lot was made out about fiscal imprudence in the parliament debate. Mr. Jetley very rightly responded to that. But it really is surprising. I actually, after listening to those 12 points, and I carefully noted all those 12 points, I promise you, every one of those points, I was itching to get up and respond because they were so okay, let me use a more parliamentary word. They were so ill-informed. An eminent person who ran this government in India for 10 years, many of them as finance minister, is commenting on the fiscal deficit at 3.5% being high in the current year, knowing full well that the GST's last month, March revenue is not going to come in. So it's a statistical point that it's 3.5%. Once you factor in the last month's GST, which will now come in April, in the earlier period, service tax, excise duty, also the CVD that was being charged on imports, all of these were duties which were coming in March itself for the month of March. So when you factor all of that in, obviously that 45,000-50,000 crores, 3.5 actually relates back to about 3.2-3.25%. Elementary, my dear Watson, what was that? I was even, actually every one of them, I wish I had those 12 points, those notes would be in my office. He spoke about GST being calculated next year at 167% of current year's estimate. 167%. Now for a layman, it may sound very nice. The same colleague whose laughter caused so much furore actually made a big hue and cry when this point was made out in Parliament and said, see what has happened when it was mentioned that 167% GST has been factored in. I was in Mumbai. Everybody and who's an economist or who's watching these numbers told me, guys, you've not given us the right GST figure. You have certainly kept a 10 to 15% for potential additional revenue, which we don't see in the GST. I said, why should we do that? We've been conservative, and our government always believes in being conservative, which is why we've been able to spend every year more than targeted. It used to never happen in the 10 years before Mr. Modi came in. Every year in the revised estimate, if you'll see what was budgeted and what was spent, you'll see a big variation. The targeted fiscal deficit, revenue deficit, you'll see a big variation. It is only in Mr. Modi and Mr. Jetley's charge that we've actually seen spending to the extent expected. We've actually seen targets being met. But now any of you can look at it very easily. GST came in July. So the government will get revenue of GST from July to February. As I said, February revenue will come in March, and March will not come at all. So July to February, each one of us here in this room will realize it's 8 months. But of course, a former finance minister may not be able to calculate that very easily. Now, 8 month revenue, when the next year will be 12 month revenue, will straight away become 150%. Kuch galat to nahi bol raha Srinivasan ji. So 8 month revenue, when you get 12 month revenue next year, will become 150% of current year estimate. Right? If you add only 10% to it, or 11%, it comes to 167%. And simple maths. It doesn't need a great economist to tell us that. Of course, the fiscal deficit at 5.9% under the UPA was certainly far better than the fiscal deficit of 3.2% that we are targeting this year. That's a fact. I think that's a very good thing. We should actually now, the whole country should start learning economics from the UPA, because it's for the first time in my life I heard that 5.9% fiscal deficit in 2011-12 was more fiscally prudent than 3.2% under Mr. Modi. So this is a new economics. So in the UPA parlance, we'll all have to go back to our business school or economics classes and learn about fiscal deficit once again, because it seems now high fiscal deficit is fiscal prudence and low fiscal deficit is imprudence. But then, like he rightly said, that is what Harvard taught him. I think he mentioned Harvard in his speech also. But probably that's what Harvard taught him. And in that sense, no wonder that most dropouts of Harvard do better than those who complete their degree at Harvard. And actually, I could go on and on about all those 12 points, but I won't labor that point too much. The fact is that today, honesty has a premium in this country. And I think that is what the youth of India were craving for years and years. I on this flight, I had about so many papers, but I could do only so many, but for good reasons. I had Mr. Anil Kapoor sitting next to me just while flying in from Mumbai today. And I couldn't help but telling him, and then of course we got into a conversation about the country and where we are headed. And I must say it was nice to see the kind of passion and enthusiasm that a film personality had about the country. But I still remember, and he mentioned to me that the year was about 2000. When the movie Nayak had come in. I don't know if any of you have had the chance to watch Anil Kapoor's Nayak. Now, I'm not getting paid to do a publicity or a promotion of that film. But I still remember my son, who was then a very, very young child, the influence that that movie Nayak had on my son. And I was telling Mr. Kapoor that I won't be surprised if my son Dhruv has seen Nayak not less than 100 times. Not less than 100 times, and I say this with full responsibility. That was the impact that that movie Nayak had on him. And what was Nayak? It was all about the despondency that the youth of today feels with the way things were happening in the country for the last 50, 60, 70 years. The anger in our youth when they see that corruption has become a way of life, it's accepted to pay a bribe and get your work done. It's a normal activity that doesn't shock any of our conscience anymore. And how one individual literally fighting corruption for one day became an excitement for a young mind barely 10 years old. And almost becoming like a role model. To my mind, the country today is happy that we finally have a leader who's willing to move beyond populism, understand the agony of poverty, understand the problems that are naturally associated with corruption, black money, evasion of taxes, and how these issues ultimately impact the common man. Because as he rightly pointed out, one must remember that every time we are evading even a single rupee of tax, every time we are bribing to break the queue or get some benefit not due to us, every time we are giving a false certificate to get a benefit, we may actually be depriving of a child in a remote village from getting electricity in his home. We may actually be depriving a poor woman of her ability to cook with clean LPG, rather than inhaling 400 cigarettes every day while she's cooking for her family. Every rupee of tax that we evade may actually deprive somebody from getting health care, which he truly deserves, or a farmer from getting a reasonable basic income, which can help him take care of his family. Actually, if all of us get into the new India with a commitment to be a part of this movement towards honesty, to be a part of a mission or a missionary zeal to change the way we work, the country works, we can really aim high. We can look for that new India of the dreams of Swami Vivekananda, the new India, the Naya Bharat, that Mahatma Gandhi had articulated in his writings. And I invite all of you to be a part of that new India. Work for it. Care for the lesser privileged sections of society. And make a difference to the lives of our country, our people. Thank you very much.